Let's bring a tumor. That's a tumor. That's right.
Welcome to Pulitzer Harbor Laboratory. You are in McClintock Laboratory, which is named after Barbara McClintock,
a
Nobel Prize winning woman scientist who discovered something called jumping genes in corn. The laboratory building that you're in is the laboratory of one of today's most important scientists in the world, right here.
Howdy. So welcome to Cold Spring Harbor.
You're the guy.
I'm a guy. All right, so you guys are in the McClintock building, and my lab occupies this entire building. We have about 40 scientists that work in the lab. They're of a bunch of different types. There are graduate students, and there's probably about 15 graduate students in the lab. There are about 15 postdoctoral fellows, which is what a graduate student becomes after they get their PhD in biology. And then we have a variety of other support staff that help us do the experiments that we do. We work in a number of different areas of biology, and there are really four main things that we do. So there's a large group in the lab that works on RNA biology. I'm sure you guys know about RNA. Do you know about RNAi? You know about small RNAs? Nobody's ever told you about this? So RNAi is a relatively new biological pathway. It was discovered, I guess about 12 or 13 years ago. A couple friends of mine got the Nobel Prize for that discovery. Ooh. 2 or 3 years ago. Wasn't me. And so one of the big areas in the lab is to try to understand that piece of biology, how this works to defend our genomes against parasitic genetic elements like transposons, like viruses. This is a very old pathway. It's about 3.6 billion years old. And it arose pretty much when our lineage diverged from bacteria. So we've done a lot of work on trying to understand that piece of biology. There's a second area of the lab that focuses on cancer genetics, cancer biology. And some of the people that you'll talk to will have been working in both of those areas. In cancer biology, we develop a lot of tools to try to understand what makes a tumor cell. And we take advantage of these RNAi pathways to turn genes off in cancer cells to try to figure out whether the cells depend on those genes. And cells that cancer cells, or genes that cancer cells depend on, are potentially good therapeutic targets. And we work in two major areas of tumor biology, and that's breast cancer and pancreatic cancer. And I think you'll talk to at least one person, I think, who does that. A third area in the lab is genomics. And the fourth area in the lab is that we do a lot of technology development. So we try to build tools that biologists can use really around the world. And we've developed a lot of the methodologies that people use to study the function of genes in animal systems, again, based on these small RNA pathways, these RNAi pathways. So Dagny told you a little bit about some of the most recent work that we've done on trying to understand the relationship between modern humans and Neanderthals. Somebody put this cheesy Neanderthal picture up. Obviously, we really don't know what they look like. There's been a long-standing, obviously, desire to understand our relationships with our closest relatives. And if you think about, I think it was 3 or 4 years ago, they sequenced the genome of the chimpanzee. And we shared our most recent common ancestor with chimpanzees about 6.5 million years ago. And so that's about when we diverged from our closest living relative. And the chimpanzee genome and the human genome are about 96.5% to 98% identical. And so, in fact, the men and women in this room are less closely related to each other genetically than any of us are to chimpanzees because of the differences, because men obviously carry a useless Y chromosome, right? So that creates more divergence than there is between us and chimpanzees. But if you think about the proteins that are encoded in our genomes, there are about, let's say, 23,000 proteins encoded on our genomes. Humans and chimps, about two-thirds of those proteins, between two-thirds and three-quarters, have at least one difference in their sequence. And so we were interested in understanding how closely related we are to Neanderthal. We worked with a world-famous paleobiologist, if you want to think about him that way, named Svante Paabo, who started a project to study ancient DNA and particularly the DNA of our human relatives about 10 or 15 years ago. And the way that we got involved in this project was initially through this technology development that we do. Emily Hodges, who you will meet, she's out there, invented an approach that essentially lets her very specifically pull out of very complex mixtures specific bits of DNA. Now, if you want to study ancient DNA, you start with something that looks like this. This is a replica, actually, of a fragment of a bone from a Neanderthal that was found in a cave in Croatia. This is an individual that lived about 38,000 years ago. It's a replica of the bone. They don't let us touch the bones.
Sure.
This is a replica of a bone from a cave in Spain from an individual that lived about 43,000 years ago. And if you think about these bones being buried in a soil or a cave somewhere, all kinds of stuff kind of crawls in there, bacteria, fungi. And even though there might be a little bit of human DNA in here, it's heavily contaminated by DNA from the environment. And so if you want to sequence the human DNA, just one second, I'll answer your question, then you have to suck it out from all of this contamination. And Emily invented the way that you do that. And so we worked with Svante Paabo to resequence all of the protein coding genes from Neanderthal and compare them to human and chimpanzee. And the bottom line, I don't know if any of you have read about this, the bottom line is that humans and Neanderthals are incredibly similar. In fact, if you look at two Neanderthal individuals, there's almost no differences between modern humans and the protein coding genes of Neanderthal. And even in the related paper where the Paabo group sequenced the entire genome, there was evidence that modern humans and Neanderthals interbred actually fairly recently during the migration of modern humans out of Africa. And so we were so similar that by a strict biological definition, you might not even call us different species. And so the human family tree is not really a tree. It's kind of a tree where the branches kind of recross, at least in this one instance. We do a lot of different things in the lab. The scientific portfolio is a little bit more diverse than you would find in most labs. And I think you'll get an appreciation for that as you talk to the students and postdocs that will kind of walk you around the lab.